The Forever Alone Filmmaking Podcast is brought to you by no one, because nobody gives a fuck if you make your films or not. That's why you've got to go out and make them on your own, pimp.
Hello and welcome to the Forever Alone Filmmaking Podcast, episode 31, as provided by our technical statistician, Jimmy Screamer Claus.
So I know numbers.
So our guest on this show is Will Sutton, who is working on a film called Tar of Zandoria. And I emailed Will when I was looking for guests, and he responded and said, hey, you know, I'm up here working on my film by myself, so I thought he was a perfect guest for the show. So welcome to the show, Will.
Hey, thank you.
So why don't you tell us a little bit about how you got started and involved in 3D and a little bit about this project that you're working on right now.
All right. Well, I've been involved in Animation Master since 1999. I kind of had a background in traditional art, and I got in and was an airbrush artist, and I got into using a computer about 15 years ago. And once I got into, I worked for a company that did POP displays, and we did a lot of concept rendering of the display. So he modeled it in CG and rendered it. After that, I'm like, I found Animation Master and started thinking about what I could do to make characters and stuff in the computer instead of painting them. And I've just been working on it ever since.
Was that something you always wanted to do? Like do animation and make animated films or something? Or
It was. It was kind of, I was a little intimidated by when I was young, like a teenager, you know, Ralph Bakshi and Fire and Ice and Wizards, things like I really loved. And, but I thought, man, I could never learn to draw that many frames of animation. It just seemed like it would be monotonous. But then, you know, when I first saw computer animation, it really just kind of hit home with me. I mean, when I picked up a mouse and set down my airbrush, I never looked back.
Yeah, and you know, looking at your blog, which I'll post in the show notes, I can tell you're, you know, an accomplished traditional artist. And I found that usually people that are really good, this in my experience, the people I know that were good traditional artists and wanted to get involved with animation, they kind of had this like this wall with 3D or computer animation where they didn't want to bridge the gap. They were comfortable with drawing and didn't want to have to go into the world of polygons. Did you have that, or did you find that?
Well, not really, though. I guess when I started using Animation Master, and I don't know if you've used other computer graphics programs like Illustrator, but mm-hmm. Animation Master uses splines, and it's a lot like drawing a curve in Illustrator.
Yeah.
Then as you draw cross-sections and connect them together, they form patches. So the surfaces are really intuitive to model, and it's kind of like just drawing on the screen. And I'll bring in a sketch and then just start laying down the splines and pushing and pulling until I have the shape that I want.
Yeah, that makes me think of something, because I saw you had a tutorial where you're doing patch modeling. So is it like the gradient mesh tool in Illustrator? Is that kind of similar to
Except
patch modeling? Is it really?
Yeah, you're in 3D, so you can just kind of lay down the grid and then pull and push it into shape.
Yeah, if people don't know what the gradient mesh tool is, can you tell them a little bit about? Because I can't really draw, and I remember being into Illustrator and like, whoa, and seeing the crazy stuff that people are making with that tool.
Yeah, as well, in the gradient mesh, you lay down cross sections of spline like a grid, and then each intersection of that in the middle of a filled shape can have different color values, so it allows you to get almost like airbrush effects.
And did that help you to go into 3D modeling? Was it kind of, with that patch modeling, is it kind of similar?
It is similar. It was a lot easier than what we were using in the design department was AutoCAD release 12 back then. So we're doing 3D models using a CAD package.
Yeah.
We switched to Rhino. But, you know, doing industrial design and CAD stuff is a lot less fun than doing the Animation Master. And, you know, you're doing things that are more mechanical and they're shaped, so you don't have the flexibility of the organic shapes that you can pull off drawing or sculpting.
I see. So it allowed you to move into 3D a little bit more comfortably because one of the tools you were using for drawing already was sort of similar to the 3D workflow that you could use.
Right. Yeah. So it was great.
So what brought you to the film or the project Tar of Zandoria? How did it go from getting into that stuff to like, you know what, I'm going to make a film? And
well, I said, I've been doing this a long time. And then I in 2004, Brian Michael Stoller emailed me. He's a director, and asked me if I could do an animated pig that was a cross between a Tyrannosaurus and a pig for a special effect in this film he was working on. And it was like, it was just 10 seconds. And 2 years later and 60 shots later, I did all of the visual effects in Miss Castaway and the Island Girls.
Mm-hmm.
When I said, yeah, I can do that, I kind of thought I could, but I really had not ever really done it. And so it was kind of throwing myself into the deep end and mastering the program. Since then, I've done SitGraph tutorials and demoed the software. I edited the technical reference for Hash.
Oh, that's awesome.
And then I did a lot of work with Martin and the other Hash fellows developing a movie called The Tin Woodman of Oz, which was a community animation project. But Tar is something that's, you know, it started out really in my 30s as an idea that I would do a kind of a heavy metal style airbrushed comic.
Mm-hmm.
And it's been in the back of my mind that eventually this is what I'm going to do in AM. And so it's kind of the most ambitious thing I've created. And I've gotten to a level now. I feel like there's nothing I should be doing in life more important than this. You know, it's like everything has built up to it, that I've gotten to the level where I think I can do this.
Yeah, it sounds like it. So from your perspective now, where you're working on the project, what are the biggest obstacles for a lone artist doing this 3D animation? What are the things that you feel are the hardest things that you'll have to get through to realize this project technically, and just everything, you know, with making a movie, making a short film?
I think the biggest thing that solo artists face is time. It's hard to carve out that time and just block it into your calendar, and every day you make time in the studio that you're going to work on the project. And when you do, everything will conspire to interrupt that. People will, you know, want you to go. My wife plans things. Well, we got this, you know, we got to go to. And so things will interrupt, and it's hard to stick to that schedule.
So it's time, just finding the time.
Yeah, and then, you know, back up your work. So when your hard drive fails, and it will, you know, you're not down for too long.
So technically, it's all there for you, an animation master. So it's nothing technical like the rigging or the viewport speed or anything. All that is there.
No, yeah, the software has gotten to a point, and I think it doesn't really matter if it's Animation Master or Blender or Maya. Yeah. And everybody can about pull off the same look. Now it's the software's matured to a point where I think if you, rather than chasing the latest software or chasing the latest feature, if you just sit down, knuckle down with the tools that you've got and master them, just like, you know, there's no magic pencil that's going to make you a better artist to draw. The software is not going to make the difference in the end. So
can you tell us a little bit about that? That's an interesting statement, because, I mean, a lot of 3D artists forget. I mean, it is, right? The 3D software is just like you said, a brush or a pencil. Can you mm-hmm. talk about that, like being a traditional artist coming into 3D? And then, because I see that a lot, too, and people arguing about packages, and, you know, then it's like, hey, it's just a tool, right?
Yeah, I mean, well, when I was an airbrush artist, you know, artists would talk about what was the best airbrush, whether, you know, Iwata or Pache, and you know, it's in the end, it doesn't matter really what it was, you know, like it's the time that you put into it in the end that made the difference of what your skill level was. And with software, I've noticed that, you know, as you learn one set of features, you know, the next calendar year's rolled around and somebody's got a new version coming out, and now we do it all this way and everything has changed, and people are posting tests, test of this, test of that. And I'm thinking, you know, they tested this before they made it a feature. But the artist on the community, they're spending their time doing tests of stuff, which means they're just really running through the features and doing little test renders of it. And they're not really using it as a tool towards a certain goal and working on that goal. They're just kind of playing with it. And I think it's easy to get distracted with that. Because, I mean, it's got all these wonderful tools, and you're just like you're never going to run out of them.
So what would that be if we were to equate it to like, traditional art? Is that someone just doing life drawing all the time, or just drawing boxes or practicing and never going out and making a painting or something?
Well, I think maybe it's continuing to buy new paintbrushes and new sets of oils or watercolor or different brands of inks and just continuing to tinker around and doodle and thinking that, you know, just the right setup or, well, just the new drawing table, or I need this lamp, and, you know, just getting the setup just right. Then I'm gonna sit down and create something.
Yeah.
Really, if they just pick up a pencil and start drawing, they'll get a lot farther.
Yeah, and I'd have to agree about, like, all the 3D software, and it doesn't really matter what you're using. Like, you can pretty much get the same output out of all of them, and I find it's amazing because, you know, I found you on CG Talk, and, you know, there's a lot of stuff people, it's kind of like operating systems where people argue about 3D programs, and this one's better, and this, and it's
very
like...
very snobbish there. It's like, you know, I'm like, for a community that's supposed to be, you know, encouraging other fellow artists in CG, it's... It doesn't feel that way when you're on there. It's like if you don't work at a major studio, your opinion doesn't matter. And it's like you ask this question, you kind of get shut down. And I'm like, okay, I'll go somewhere else.
Yeah, I was actually banned there years ago because of that same thing, that I was stating my position. And then someone who worked at a studio disagreed with me. And they were like friends with the moderator, and they just decided to ban me because I had a difference in opinion. And then I started quoting lines from Superman 2 and told them to kneel before Zod and so on. But yeah, so I have had my experiences there at CG Talk.
Kneel before Zod or Lee.
Yeah. So, I mean, how do you, like, that's kind of an interesting thing because, you know, we want to look to our peers, right? Like, you would think your peers would support you. And like, hey, I'm just a guy. I have a, you know, some software. I have this idea. I want to make this movie. And I, you know, that's how I was. I was like, oh, there must be other people out there who want to do the same thing, and we can like help each other and support each other. But yeah, I kind of found that it was pretty abrasive, or you're doing this wrong, or you need to do this, and this happens. And so I just kind of went off on my own and didn't really ask too much in those places anymore.
Yeah. Now there's a community for Animation Master. And, you know, that's kind of where I'll hang out, because the people who are left that are using Animation Master, they're kind of past that feature orgy chasing the latest and greatest thing.
I like that, feature orgy.
Martin Hash coined that one. It was very frustrating to him every time there was a, quote, professional that wanted some new feature added to the software so that, you know, we could compete with Maya. You know, it was always seemed to be frustrating to him. They would treat him, he said they'd treat him like a garage mechanic.
Really? Yeah, I can see that. There's, you know, I've seen and I've learned a ton from, like, you know, Jeff Liu, the Killer Bean Master, because he started with Animation Master and he had those awesome tutorials in it. And yeah, from what I've seen, it's like one of the best animation programs still.
Yeah, I love it. And, you know, after this much time in it, I thought, there's just no reason, unless it were incompatible with my machine or something, that, I mean, there's no reason to switch to something else because, you know, the learning curve, I'm going to have to start over again.
Can you say something about that too? Because I found, you know, usually it's like Max or Maya, but, you know, you're making your stuff with Animation Master. I'm using Cinema 4D. Jimmy's using Cinema 4D and DAZ and some different things. Mm-hmm. Are we at, where do you think that comes from? And if you're starting up, if you know, starting out, does it really matter?
I don't think it does. You know, if somebody was just starting out and they have an ambition to get into a more mainstream you know, to apply for a job at different studios, I would probably steer them towards something like Maya or something, just because it's the de facto standard.
Yeah.
And when you're dealing with spline mesh models like the patches that are in Animation Master, nobody else uses that. So you can export into other packages and you can import things, but it's really a pain. It's not an effortless thing like, you know, being in ZBrush and having a plugin that takes you out to Maya and back again. And it's just simpler to stay in one program and say you're building your character, I'll bring in a sketch, I'll model it, texture it, and rig it and animate it, and I'm staying in Animation Master the whole time, and I'm not worrying about how am I going to get it from one program to another or using words like pipeline. I mean, I've got one pipeline. It's this program and then the video editing software and Photoshop. So that's about all I need.
Yeah, and when you export your work, it's compatible with everybody's eyeballs, right? There hasn't been anyone who's seen the images or animations you create and like, I can't see this. You made it with an incompatible program.
Yeah, no one cares except the people who are on CG Talk.
Did you hear that, listeners? Nobody cares.
I'm not trying to bash CG Talk. That's just the impression I get from being on there.
Yeah, and you know, something I saw on there that I thought was great is that like this amazing, someone asked about how did Rooster Teeth do this animation? It was like crazy amazing, like fight character animation. And then it came out that the guy uses Poser, and then it kind of, there was like crickets. I was like, oh.
Well, it sucks.
You know, like, no, they couldn't say anything because it was awesome character animation. I was like, whoa. And then it's like, oh, the guy uses Poser. And it was like, oh, well, okay. That isn't happening. But, yeah, if you can, I mean, you don't have to put, you know, release any spoilers. So tell us something about the Tar film, Tar of Zandoria. Okay. Like, how what's it about, kind of? When do you expect to have it finished and kind of that kind of stuff?
All right, so if you imagined Kung Fu Panda if Quentin Tarantino had directed it. That's my elevator pitch. You know, he's a hippopotamus barbarian, kind of like a Conan the Barbarian or Zatoichi. Mm-hmm. His solution to life's problems is a big spiky club. And so it's, you know, it's violent. I want to have that kind of juxtaposition of the cute, funny animal look with sprays of blood like you would see in an old samurai movie.
Cool.
And, you know, the kind of thing that'll make everybody love it except your mom.
Yeah. And I say we need more of that. There's enough kid stuff already, so.
Yeah, I think that look has become really kind of homogenized in the last few years as you see Pixar and DreamWorks and Disney and Blue Sky. The look of the CG animation is like the same. You kind of have to ask which studio did it. Because like I said, you know, all the software is attaining the same level. But the artistry is looking, it seems like everybody's shooting for the same look. And that kind of bugs me a little bit. So I'm trying to mix it up a little bit with things you don't expect, like the violence with these little fuzzy, I've got these fuzzy ninja hyenas, you know, they have a texture that's almost like a plushie.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, when their head gets lopped off and there's the big gout of blood, I just think this is going to be hilarious. So that's the look. And then my backgrounds, I'm using a lot of digitally painted stuff.
Yeah, I thought those looked awesome.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of Frank Frazetta. It's probably the biggest influence on me. So Frank Frazetta, Boris Vallejo, that kind of oil-painted background. Mm-hmm. That is classic and fantasy artwork. I want to kind of bring that into the backgrounds and then have these barbarian characters that are anthropomorphic African animals and kind of mix that all up, like I say, with the violence and stuff mixed in there too.
Yeah, and you can save a lot, right, by using matte paintings like that with the detail that they bring in and not have to put all this crazy geometry in the background and stuff.
Yeah, and it's great. You know, in Animation Master, they have something called layers, and you can basically bring in an image or even an image with an alpha channel and almost do like multi-plane camera, like the old Disney stuff.
Oh, that's awesome.
And so rather than having to render everything out in passes, you can almost composite the whole shot in 3D, throw a background in there and have different layers. And those layers could be video or animated layers too. So you can kind of composite the shot and only have part of it being 3D action.
Yeah.
And then render the composited shot all in one go.
So, so where is Tar right now and where are you taking it?
Right now, like I said, I'm doing this Kickstarter to fund the first episode. Mm-hmm. I see the whole thing is like 7 to 10 minute episodes.
Mm-hmm.
If you've read a lot of fantasy novels, Conan and stuff, the novels seem to be basically little short episodes strung together to form a larger tale or saga. And I feel like I can do the same thing with animation. Little short bits of story that kind of string together into a long saga that, you know, I can end up putting it together into a, you know, maybe a DVD collection.
Yeah.
But beyond that, because each thing I make is reusable, the sets and backgrounds and elements and the characters, you know, as I go along, I'm building a library of these assets.
Your digital backlot.
That's right. And but rather than just keep it to myself, I want to make it, and this is kind of unique, I think, I want to make it open source and put it back out there into the Animation Master community with some kind of open source license and allow other creators to take these same assets and tell their stories, kind of the same way that Conan kept going after Robert E. Howard died. You know, that it takes on a life of its own.
Yeah, that's awesome.
So I think that would be great.
Yeah, we've talked about that on this podcast, about making a resource for other independent animators with mm-hmm. our props from our movies and our stuff. It can be reused, so you can just go somewhere and, like, I need a chair or I need a, you know, garage or something. So, yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah. So that's where I think I'll go after I get done. I've got probably probably a dozen stories will make maybe a movie's worth of Tar of Zandoria. And then, you know, other people are probably going to want to do their own fan films and stuff. And I'm thinking, hey, great, you know, put it out here and let them use it. One of the Kickstarter rewards is I'm going to put the models from the first episode on a DVD so that, you know, another animator can play with those assets, you know, right away.
Yeah, that's something I think is awesome that I've seen, like, the Blender community does with their films, right? They put out, like, everything. They give them everything and tutorials and making of. And have you checked any of that stuff out?
I have watched some of the Blender films, the Big Buck Bunny, and there was another one. I can't remember the name of it, though.
There was a Sintel one, and I envy those community things because the stuff Cinema 4D, there's really not anybody making films with it. So there's no community like that. So I look to other ones like Animation Master or Blender. I'm like, that's awesome. You can have friends.
Yeah, that's part of the name of your podcast, you know, that Forever Alone. It is, I've looked on meetup.com to try to find any other animators anywhere. Like, you know, is there anybody within, you know, 50 miles of Chattanooga that wants to meet up and talk about animation? And, you know, it's just hard to find people that are into the same thing.
I found it's hard to find animators, one. And then if you find them, usually, they're working on other people's stuff or, they're working professionally for a studio or something. But it's very, very rare to find someone who is doing their own projects, too.
Yeah.
Or that understands the entire, is the generalist who knows how to do everything. Like, you talk to modelers or animators, and you talk to other, talk about other facets of 3D, and they're just kind of like, well, I don't do that. The 2D does that or something.
Yeah. We had a thing we called the hash bash. I think this was started in 2005 when Martin had the idea. Martin Hash, he's the creator of Animation Master. Yeah. So he thought, you know, let's make a movie. Let's get all the power users together. And it's a group he calls the Hash Fellows. And we all took our vacations and we flew out there to Portland. And we stayed with Martin in his big house and brainstormed, you know, for a long weekend, and just came up with the Tin Woodman of Oz as a property, since it was public domain, that we could build a film around and then shake down the software in what does it lack, you know, that to pull off a feature film. And, you know, the programmers were all there, and they built in SVN into the software so that you could have a central repository of assets, and people who are all working on the same thing, as they log into the program, it would download and update their files with the latest version. And, you know, there were people all over the country, I think, in other countries, that ended up working on that film.
Really? Is it on YouTube or something?
It's on YouTube, yeah. And they did a second film with the same assets called The Scarecrow of Oz. I wasn't involved with that one, and I was only involved really at the, I guess, during the first year of the Tin Woodman of Oz project. I've worked on the art direction and, you know, more of the foundation of it, rather than doing the animation and stuff.
Yeah, that's an awesome project. That must have been tons of fun.
And it was. And, you know, it was one of those divisive things. It was great in some ways, and it was calamitous in others, because, you know, artists have egos, and there were so many people that got involved, and, you know, it was hard to get, you know, I was surprised that it got finished, and it's a pretty good film, given how many people were in it, how many people packed up their toys and went home and didn't want to play with everybody anymore. So there were some people that, you know, got their feelings hurt and left the community and the program altogether. And, but then there was new people who came on and, got involved doing, and we had like an animation boot camp. So they were getting coaching from, more experienced animators on the forum and bringing their skill level up, and then they're eventually animating shots in the film. And, you know, they're really the kind of the core of those new people that came on, or kind of the core of the community that's left now on the Animation Master Forum. Some of the old guard are gone, you know, and some of the ones who started the project, but then, you know, there's whole new people there.
Yeah, so that's a great project. And how's it, I mean, you mentioned you're in Chattanooga. I think I was doing some research. Doesn't Chattanooga have like the fastest internet in the whole country?
Yeah, I don't know why that is, but apparently we are the freaking backbone of the internet.
Yeah, you have like 1,000 whatever, like the Google Fiber speed connect. Have you found that to help your online collaboration or anything, or do you notice it?
I don't have it. I've got Comcast. And
oh, no.
I think, you know, I'm going to have to talk to my wife and let us upgrade, because, you know, they're pitching that on the news. And I'm like, you know, let's get on this EPB. I'm not sure, you know, which company has that. But I'm like, if we have the fastest internet on the planet, we need to get some of that.
Yeah, because, you know, overall, the United States is 34th in download speed and 44th in upload speed in the whole world. But Chattanooga is like number one. You would have like the fastest internet. And from what I was reading, it's because you didn't sell out your public services. You kept them... they're public, they didn't go private, so mm-hmm. I guess you have super fast, affordable internet. That's what I was reading. Sound like Chattanooga was a super high-tech, cool place.
Yeah, and maybe my internet speed is faster than I think it is. But
better go to speedtest.net.
Yeah, I think somebody, it might be EPB that is putting that out, but I'm going to have to check into which company here. There's three different places that provide internet, so I'm not sure who has the fastest but I mean, God, I should take advantage of that, or at least, you know, make that part of Zandoria Studios' pitch if I was trying to, you know, promote it as a business. I'm like, hey, you know, ours has the fastest internet in the
world. And if you're going to work with other people, like, you know, when you have that kind of speed, it's like being on a physical network. You know, it's like you could be working with anybody in the world. Granted, they have a fast enough connection. And that's something kind of I envision in the future, because there's other people I collaborate with online in different facets, voice actors or sound editors, whatever. And if we had that fast connection, you know, you would be like on the same local network. So you'd be at the same studio, but anywhere in the world. And you could, you know, use their computers to render on and stuff because the connection is fast enough. So if you got that, if you have access to it, you should check it out.
Yeah, I could do that, and I could host the Tar of Zandoria data and use the SVN to let people log into it. I guess might be a way to control what happens to it.
Yeah, it'd be like a network drive.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, thanks for being on the podcast, Will. And if there's any, we'll put, make a link to your blog. Is that the site that you want people to check out? And your Kickstarter is going to be on there? Or?
Yeah, the Kickstarter will be on there. I'm actually finishing up the video this week, and then I'm going to hit the submit button. Everything is ready to go. So I'm hoping the month of April, I either, you know, succeed or fail at raising funds for producing this first episode.
So everybody that's listening, go check out Will's blog and check out his Kickstarter when it comes up.
Yeah.
And yeah, thanks for being on the Forever Alone Filmmaking Podcast, and we wish you the best of luck with your project, and we'd like to have you come back, you know, when you the project goes further or whatever. We'd like to hear, you know, how things are going.
All right, cool. I'd be glad to.
So thanks for being on the show, and good luck with your film.
All right, thank you.
All right, thanks, Will.
See you later, Will.
Sure. Thank you, guys.
Sure. Bye. Jimmy.
MemDot.
Don't you wish we had the fastest internet ever?
Oh, it doesn't really bother me all that much, honestly. As long as the page loads quick.
Doesn't bother
but
you.
But I also don't upload a whole lot, so I mean, maybe I'm not really that affected by it.
Yeah, you know, like, because the thing is, like that Google Fiber, I don't know if you know about that, but they set it up in Kansas City, Kansas. It's like their test city. But that's the same speed as gigabit Ethernet.
Mm-hmm.
So by having that connection, you know, you could be, as long as the other person had that connection too, like you're on the same physical network. So you could render on their computer, you know, you can whatever. It's like,
oh yeah, that would be awesome. That could. Do they charge a lot more for it though?
No, it's what, $60.
Oh, well, that's what I pay now.
Yep.
So I deserve that. You are correct. My $60 is not being well spent. And it's actually $70, so it's even less well spent.
Yep, and the Google thing, you know, they don't give a shit. Like Comcast or with a lot of these ISPs have that six strike law now, so they're monitoring our downloads to make sure we're not pirating shit, and they'll send us fines and stuff like that, but Google doesn't give a shit about that.
Yeah. I'm still on a privately owned one, so they do get mad for downloading too much, but now I'm on an unlimited plan, so I can do whatever I want.
But they're watching you, man. Six strikes.
I have a commercial account now. I'm a business.
All right. I'm a bit, you know, like, that's what's funny, too. Like, you know, I look at myself as some jerk off, right? But I have a corporation here in California. So I'm the president of a corporation in California, right? And I won't say what it is, but technically, I'm the CEO of my own corporation in California, right? MemDot Strange Inc. I'm a CEO, right? And then in Nevada, I'm the fucking president of a nonprofit organization. I won't say what it is, because I can't affiliate like my real, like MemDot Strange with that thing, but it's like, yeah.
Thing.
No, it's not like a bad thing. It's a good thing, but I'm kind of a bad man to be involved with it as MemDot Strange. Uh-huh. So, yeah, if anybody doesn't think I'm legit, I'm like, well, I'm the CEO of a corporation and the president of a nonprofit
organization. You're legit as fuck, bro.
Like, I just made business cards and I didn't put that on there. I was like, shit.
People go to business school for years and never become a CEO or a president. In one state, let alone two.
Yeah. We're big pimping.
Well, you are. I'm not CEO of anything.
Like, I think I talked about
that. I'm still just lowly old Jimmy.
CEO?
I'm no CEO.
So, Jimmy, So tell us what's going on now with your film. What are you working on? How are things going in the Jimmy Screamer Claws world?
I'm about halfway done with that music video, I think, the one I'm doing for Grim the Rapist. So, I mean, that's coming along nice, so I can get that done and then focus more on the movie. But I've been going back and forth between the two.
Yeah. So it's moving forward.
Yeah, they're moving forward slowly. They're each moving slowly. But I remember reading on your blog about the rendering and stuff, and like the way I've been doing is I've just been doing one computer at a time. Like, I haven't been running all of them.
I think that's what I'm going to do.
Because, like, I mean, even with the feature film, like, you know, I animate that for 2 days or whatever, and then have a big backlog of shots, and then while I'm animating the music video, those are all rendering on one computer. So, I mean, it's not as fast, but usually, you know, by the time I'm ready to work on the movie again, those shots are finished. Or at least half of them are finished.
Yeah, I think that's the way I'm going to do it. Because running one computer 24 hours a day can't, like, destroy your power bill, I'm hoping.
No, I mean, it's still, you know, it's going to cost money, but it just won't cost as much as doing four at once, or five, whatever you have.
Yeah.
What do you have, five, including your workstation?
One, two, three, four, five. Yeah, five. I had six.
Yeah, so you have four vendor slaves.
But one's in Iceland now, my backup computer over there. Well, so yeah, I was thinking, like, you know, we're going to that Victoria Film Festival thing next week or two, so I thought, like, oh, I should put some shots on a render while I'm gone.
Yeah, there you go. So you just keep one computer running, or two, whatever.
And there's this app program called TeamViewer that runs on PCs and Android and iPhone or whatever, so you can control your computer across the internet, so then I could log in with my phone or my laptop and check my render computer progress, so that'll make me feel super high-tech.
Yeah, my mom's boyfriend's always ranting about that because he does it for work. So every time I see him for any family event, he gives me a whole team viewer speech.
Yeah, I think it's pretty amazing. Like, so you could be in Texas, Jimmy, and pull out your smartphone device.
I don't have one.
Well, if you had one. I only have one because Google gave me one for free. It's like some old one. But, I mean, that's pretty fucking cool, right? That you could pull it out and, like, let me check my renders.
Yeah, I mean, it'd be awesome.
And then you're like, oh, they all failed. Okay.
You can do it from a laptop too, though, right?
Yeah.
Well, yeah, I can do that. I have a laptop.
Yeah. So I think I'm going to try that because, well, for now. I mean, if I have the whole movie animated and I need to render it, then I'll look into those other things. But for now, but, you know, this preview render thing is, I think, it makes animating so much more fun.
Yeah, probably. I still haven't tried it, but. It seems like it would make it easier for sure. I mean, just because you wouldn't have to re-render as much.
Yeah, and you know, what I would do is, like, I'd render out, like, a 10-second shot and then use, like, 2 seconds. So this way, if you render the 10 seconds, which takes no time because it's a hardware preview, and then you only end up using two, then when you do the final render, only render 2 seconds. You know, don't waste that fucking power and money and everything.
Sometimes some of my shots have trouble if you don't... like, if you do middle frames instead of one to whatever.
Yeah.
Like, we just did 300 to 500. Like, sometimes it just won't even start.
Yeah, a lot of, like, particles or simulations. Yeah, you'd have to do zero to whatever. But it's usually me doing it from the beginning. Yeah, it's kind of, you'd have to bake everything or cache it all. So
see, that doesn't even work for me half the time. Like, when I do the full final bake, like, it always misses something somehow. So it always just the same problem.
Yeah, that's something that... like, I started doing, you know, I have the new character rigs with, like, the lip sync thing. So I'm using the sound effector from MoGraph, like, to load the audio in to control the mouth. And I found if I try to do, you know, the save as project or say, you know, that you have to do to send it to the render thing. Like, it says, cannot find bitmap image for sound effector, like, every time. So... I've learned now before I send a shot to render, I'll have to bake all the keyframes for the lip sync and then delete the sound effector because it keeps saying that, like, there's an image file missing for the sound effector when it doesn't have textures.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so I learned that. So that.
It doesn't take that long, though, right?
Nah, it's just like, you know, I would animate them and then before I go to render them, just go. I have this little plugin that I bought a long time ago for $5 where you put this tag on any device. Or on any object, and then you just press play and let it play through, and then it bakes keyframes on everything on there. So,
oh yeah, I think I've seen that before.
Yeah, I think the dude discontinued it, but it still works for like 11 and 12.
So you're still back in the old days. So I don't know what works on these new ones.
Yeah, the new one, dude. I can't do it.
It's still just because of that the visual selector.
Yeah. So. I wanted to do this tutorial series about making a film. I'm all stoked about it and shit, and I outlined it. And then I go to 14, and I modeled the set, put the characters in there, and then just trying to work animate in it with that fucking visual selector, and I can't do it. Like, it's just like, I'm supposed to make this tutorial where I'm showing people it's fun and easy, but then I'm like, shit, fuck.
Shit, where's the button?
What the hell? Oh, god damn it, shit. So, like, visual selector used to be a plugin that a developer made, so I contacted the dude who made the original one, and he's like, hey, well, alright, well, let me know some features you want in it, and I'll fucking make a new one that'll work with 13 and 14, so. So I hit that dude up, but I mean, he's a busy developer,
yeah,
so.
You never know when that's gonna happen.
Yeah, but, and then I went on these forums, and there was like a dude who worked for Maxon, and he's like, no, just do it this way, it's a better way. And I was like, okay, well, thanks, dude, but
blasphemy.
But it's like, hey, I'm the one making movies in it, like animating six characters in a scene. Like, the way you want me to work is like fine for one character, but if you're doing fucking multiple, it's just a bitch. So I was just like, okay, thanks. So I'm still using the old one.
So you're damned if you do and you're damned if you don't.
Yep. And then, you know, they're gonna come out with 15 pretty soon.
I can't believe how fast they came up with 14, honestly. It seems like they're like, they're just coming out faster than they used to. And they don't even do the half versions anymore.
Yeah, they used to do 0.1, 0.5, but they stopped doing that because they have that service thing, Maxon service agreement, and I think that changed it. But from what I was reading, they partner with Adobe. So people are thinking in the new version, you'll be able to open your Cinema 4D scenes in After Effects and have shit be editable.
Well, that's cool. I don't have any problem with that.
Yeah, in the new ones.
Making so. Everything cut down on everything. That's fine with me.
Yeah, I mean, because I thought, you know, you saw the Element 3D plugin, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's like this other dude who has, you know, resources, but not resources of Maxon and Adobe, was able to create, like, dope-ass 3D models and lights and all this shit inside of After Effects. So it's like, hey, guys.
I haven't actually tried it yet, though.
It's, yeah, it's pretty dope.
Have you done it before?
No, I've just seen the demos, but.
Yeah, that's what I saw, too.
He's doing, like, whole cities and all this stuff in there. So, hopefully they'll bring something useful, but I shouldn't be, you know, complaining unless I'm, you know, all these software makers have feature request forms. So if you want some new feature or whatever, you go to their, and I've done that before, you go to their site and submit features. And shit that I submitted for Cinema 4D is actually in it now, so.
Oh, yeah? So you changed the future of this program.
But I need to submit something about the visual selector.
That's what you gotta do. Gotta get them on their game.
It's kind of like if a different way to put it is like, say you were a puppeteer and you had like the standard fucking puppet controller, you know, the cross.
Mm-hmm.
And then you came in to work and then they were using like a circle with like buttons. And you're like, what is this? And it gets better. And you're like, but no, it's not. I can't use it. I work fine with the other one. No, this one's better. Use it.
It's better for you. Just yeah. Take it.
It's like, okay.
Well, that's not right.
No, it's not.
So they completely changed it? It's not that it's just slightly different? They didn't add to it? They just regutted it all together?
They added to it, but the way they added to it, like, made it slower, like, to work with. Because before, you would just, like, say you wanted the hand controller to be in the visual selector. You would just drag the hand controller, drop it into the window, and then it's there, and you just click on it and control it. Now, you have to drag it and drop it and then paint, like, a circle or whatever for it to be, you know, accessible.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to do that, and then when you would click on the controller, you would actually see its parameters in the attribute manager, like, you know, position, rotation, you can see if keyframes or whatever on it. But that doesn't work anymore. Doesn't do that.
And so that all confuses me. I don't even know what that really is because I've never used it before. But
it's just, let's say
that's like half your thing right there, right? So
yeah, instead of clicking once, I have to click like three times and use like a shortcut.
Yeah,
to do something, and it's just like if you're doing that fucking 1,000 times a day, it's just like, yeah, this sucks. So.
Well, what in the new versions would you really want? Like, what have they added that you can't do in 11.5?
Just deformers.
Oh, that's true, I guess. Well, I mean, couldn't you just do your character animation in 11.5 if you wanted, and then import it into a new thing?
Yeah, like, I'm looking at I want to do some speed tests with the demos and see. And I think, I did do some speed tests with the demos. And R13, they get faster. With the newer versions, they render faster.
Mm-hmm.
So I think I did a shot and it was like 46 seconds to render in 11.5. And then it was like 38 seconds to render in 13.
Mm-hmm.
So actually save time and money if you do it in 13. So
yeah, maybe you can just do your animation, your character animation in 11.5 and then
yeah,
need any performers or anything like that, and then switch your net render over to 13 and 14.
Yeah, and what we were talking about before, like, you know, were you both using ZBlur to do the depth passes?
Mm-hmm.
So ZBlur up to 13 is single threaded, so it only uses one CPU in your render, but the new version for 13 uses all your CPUs, so then that's going to be fucking 4 to 8 times faster. So I'd have to be an idiot to not render in 13.
Well, even if you just make net render and the, you know, the renderer and the client,
really,
the new version, I mean, why wouldn't it work that way?
Oh,
because
yeah,
then you're just, you're rendering through that.
So I could work in 11.5 and just use 13 clients.
Yeah. And, well, you'd have to use 13 server, too, but yeah.
And 13 plugin. I never thought of that. That's a great idea, Jimmy.
See, I'm full of them.
You
full
may have just saved my life.
Well, I mean, you still want to be able to use the new deformers or whatever, but...
Well, actually, 12, because, you know, like, 11.5 and 12 are still compatible.
Mm-hmm.
So 12 has most of all the new deformers except for the collision one. I think that's 13, and I don't really care about that. I've tried
and
using
12,
it. It's cool.
12
it's
doesn't
slow.
Have the broken visual selector?
No.
Oh, then why don't you just use 12 the whole time?
Yeah, I could. I just, it's for some reason it crashes more than 11.5. So 11.5 is solid for me. Do you get crashes at all when you're working?
Sometimes, but I almost always think it's interposer related.
Oh, okay.
I don't think it's ever Cinema 4D related. Because it's pretty much always when loading something from there that it crashes.
Yeah, because there's...
Or if I have too much shit going on, which is a lot of the time.
Craziness going on in that bitch.
Yeah, too much craziness. It's a curse, really.
Yeah, I'm trying to keep it simple, you know. It's like, this movie's going to be simple, visually simple, simple. And then I'm like fucking tweaking these scenes out, adding all this stuff. And I was like, I thought I was supposed to keep it simple. So I turn it off when I'm animating. So I might feel the heat when I have to come to render shit.
Mm-hmm. I have these, I don't know what it is, but I have this this group of flowers in my new movie, in the actual movie, not the music video, when... Whenever they're in any shots, it automatically skyrockets up to, like, 20 minutes a frame for rendering. And I have no idea why. Like, they have no...
There's no anti-aliasing on?
They're, like, stock. Just stock flowers. I didn't even make them, you know?
Do you have anti-aliasing on?
No.
Yeah, I've had...
What's the fault?
Objects like that, you know, they just... The render lines come to that, and they just go... Grr. So I would just, like, remodel them or fucking create different versions. I've had that happen, and it just kills your renders.
Mm-hmm. I'm wondering now if it did have anti... Oh, no. It's on geometry by default, it looks like.
Oh, so it's on, but on geometry, not best.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's probably... It's anti-aliasing, then, most likely.
Maybe I'll just turn it off for those shots, see if that makes a difference. I didn't even think of that.
Yeah, or you can change the types of anti-aliasing... And I think in the new version, they have, like, yeah, you can change the types and, like, the settings and anti-aliasing, too. Like, they have, like, that small fragment thing. Have you ever seen that in the preferences, if I remember correctly?
Small fragment. I'll have to look for it.
But, yeah, you got to watch out for those. Because that can make a render go from, like, 2 minutes per frame to, like, 15.
Yeah, I didn't even think I was doing it, but I just... When you said that, I just thought, you know, maybe it is left on by default. I didn't even think of that. Because I just never went and manually turned it on. So that, in my brain, that just means it's not off.
Yeah, like, you know, in Heartstring Marionette, like in the Nether War, whatever, when the dude runs across that bridge in the beginning where the kid is.
Mm-hmm.
So I had made these, like, statue things made from, like, the heads. They were, like, doll head 3D models, like real geometry of these doll heads that were painted. and had like what did they have, like these weird wood thing, like kind of owl looking heads and whatever. So I made this geometry, and it wasn't that high polygon, right? But when I had, you know, four of them, like it rendered okay, but then there's like fucking 300 of them.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it would take like forever to render. So then what I did is just look at the original object, and then out of just like spheres and fucking cubes, I just created a super like doughy shitty version of it, but then textured it with body paint, like painted it to make it look pretty similar to the other one. And then so like the ones closest to the camera are the real ones, like the real 3D ones, and then the other fucking 400 are just these shit versions, but you can't even tell. It's like close enough. It's the same size, same, you know, same proportions and similar texture. So you might want to just remodel, make if there's no close-ups of those flowers, just make a kind of crappy version.
Yeah, I might do that too. Except they're just stock flowers. I think, I don't even remember if they're poser models or if they're the ones in like Cinema 4D's library that comes with it.
Yeah, and the, like a lot of those imported models, sometimes they have those weird like normal tags on them that I have to delete and weird shit that does things. So, or you know what kills stuff too is like if it has ambient occlusion on the texture.
Oh, see, I didn't even think to check for that either.
Yeah, check the textures, because ambient occlusion just kills render time. It just gets to
what tag would it be under?
Probably in the diffusion.
I'll definitely have to look into that then.
Yeah, look for the, and you know what you can, the way you can tell, I think, is that if you're using ambient occlusion, it shows up in your render settings, like it's an effect.
Oh, then no, it's definitely not in there. I noticed that.
Okay. I'm pretty sure. I might be wrong, but I think
goddamn flower drama.
It adds it, yeah. Don't let those some bitches kill your scenes.
Flowers is making my 20 minutes a frame.
Yeah, I had some of those problems.
But I just want such pretty flowers in every shot. It's really, you know, it's a good trade, I think. And they're punishing me for it.
Those flowers are costing you money, Jimmy.
I know.
Oh, damn it.
Everyone's after Jimmy's money. He doesn't even have any.
Damn it.
They all want.
That's how it is.
They all want.
So, yeah, me and Jimmy are going to go to this film festival thing. And I guess, can you talk about that in public? Why?
I don't know.
Oh.
Nobody said not to yet.
So let's just say that they were supposed to play Where the Dead Go to Die. Right?
Yes and no. Like, originally they just wanted to show affection.
Well, dude, their website had it.
And then when I saw the flyer, it said Where the Dead Go to Die.
So
and
I'm
then
sure.
I got a message today that says it's no longer Where the Dead Go to Die, it's affection again.
Okay, because I know Josh is probably listening to this, so he's probably laughing. But so there's, or hopefully not crying because of what happened. So terrible. So they were supposed to play Where the Dead Go to Die, but then something happened in that city that there may be things in Where the Dead Go to Die that they thought would exacerbate like people's feelings because it's similar to this crime that was committed in the city. So then,
but the crime was also semi-linked to the festival. It was someone who had something to do with the festival.
Yeah. So then they decided they can't show Where the Dead Go to Die because it might make people die inside.
Yeah.
So
tagline.
So they're showing the short affection. So anybody out there want to come see Where the Dead Go to Die? We're sorry.
We had our dream double feature finally that we talked about since the first episode we talked about it.
Oh yeah,
31 episodes ago was the first time.
I didn't even realize that.
The very first episode we talked about how, because Heartstring Marionette wasn't done yet, and my movie hadn't come out yet, but it was about to.
And it was thwarted by a criminal.
Yes.
A sex criminal.
Sex criminal. Oops.
So, now we're being vague enough. So, yeah.
The people can connect the dots now.
So, but we're still going to be there. And I'm looking forward to watching movies. That's the thing, you know, like, when I first went to festivals, I was like, oh man, I don't want to watch movies. Like, what am I doing? And then after, I was like, what the fuck? I never watch movies. Like, you get a festival, you get a free pass, fucking watch all of them.
Yeah, so I went to a bunch of them when me and Victor went to Fantasia a bunch of years ago.
Yeah,
so. A couple that didn't come out that were good too. Like one that was called White Lightning.
Mm-hmm.
It was like an exaggerated story about that Jesco White dude, the tap dancing glue huffer or paint huffer, whatever he does.
I never heard of that.
He's it's a real documentary. There's like three of them about him now, but it was pretty good. But never seen that show come out on DVD, and that was like 2009, 2010.
Is it online though? You can watch it.
I don't think so. I think it's still like just playing festivals, trying to find a distributor, or you can get it straight from the creators. I don't know.
I don't know why people.
I mean, but it had like Carrie Fisher in it, you know, Princess Leia and shit, and had a couple other stars.
Oh, so they're like, need to recoup our budget. Ah.
Yeah, I'm sure it was like, you know, I mean, it was still an indie movie, but it was probably like a $2 million indie movie or whatever.
Yeah.
Or maybe not even, who knows, but still a lot of money that needs to be made.
Yeah, that's just kind of crappy, like, when, I know why they do it, but it's like, say there was some film that was on the festival circuit, came out in 2011, and then people hear about it in 2013, and like, oh, sweet, where can I watch it? And if there's no festivals in the area, you can't. And it's just like, oh, well, then you forget about it, and then you'll probably never watch it ever again, so.
And it was like the buzz of the festival. It was like, that was the movie everyone who was there was talking about. Like, that was the big festival buzz movie. That's why we went to see it, because we wouldn't have heard of it otherwise, but everyone was talking about it.
And then now, can't watch it.
And now it's just still not out. Still just floating around somewhere.
Yep.
I thought it was awesome, so if anyone ever finds White Lightning, check it out.
Time passes for everything, gotta try to do it when you can, so that's why pretty soon this year, I already uploaded Heartstring Marionette in its entirety to YouTube, so... Mm. I'll add it to the movie section probably pretty soon. I just got to talk to Endica to make sure he's not going to bash me over the head with his upright bass if I do it.
I saw that it leaked on the Cinemageddon tip.
What did? Did it?
Heartstring Marionette, yeah.
And those fuckers banned me for low ratio and they're playing my movie.
Where did Dead Go to Die's on there now, too?
Are you still on Cinemageddon? You got back in?
Yeah, I'm back on.
Yeah.
See, the key to get a ratio is to just upload something really weird that nobody else thought of, and then you get a bunch of credits, and they just use those credits to buy the 100 gigabyte credit or whatever.
Yeah, I was like...
And you just manipulate it from there. It's like a game, M.Dot.
I was not too far from that. So isn't that funny? Like, I was telling Will earlier that I got banned from CG Talk. Like, I'm a fucking 3D animated filmmaker, like, all these people on there, like, let's make our own IP, let's make our own content, it's about creating, and then, like, the dude who does it, like, gets banned, and then years later, you know, they had that feature article about me last year?
Did they?
Yeah, on their front page, I didn't mention that they banned me before, and then, I mean, that shit's the same thing. It's like, hey, you know, I was a part of this, or I could, well, what, I'm banned, okay.
You should email him and be like, hey, my movie's on here. Give me something.
Yeah, like I was on.
I want something now.
I'm on this like fucking B-movie site and then I get banned for low ratio and it's like, it was like 0.2, 0.1 under two. I was like, come on. I think I even fucking posted in the forum. I was like, hey, I'm an independent filmmaker. I made this film because I had We Are the Strange on there too. I was like, I made this one and I'm going to make, I made this one. I'll upload it later when it's done. And like, I don't think everybody responded because usually people that are film fans usually want to make films too.
I was thinking of uploading our mixtape, the one of me, you, and Emily Victor's stuff. I might do it still. I'm still giving it away. Every order I get, I send it out.
Yeah, do it.
So fuck it, might as well just throw it on there. It's a free thing anyway.
Well, that's what I almost ask Will about CG Talk and your peers, because you know we would assume, I don't know if we talked about this before, that people that want to do what you're doing would support you.
Mm-hmm.
But usually, more often than not, they fucking hate on you because you're doing the thing that they want to do, and they're not doing it because they have these fucking excuses as to why they can't. So if you're actually doing it, then they'll have to admit to themselves that their excuses are bullshit. So instead of, you know, admitting to the truth, they want to hate on you and eschew you away and make pretend you don't exist.
Mm-hmm. Well, I wouldn't upload it as me anyway. I'd still pretend to be somebody else.
Yeah. Yeah, I should do it.
I'll put it up there. I mean, I got a big enough ratio that they're not going to bother me.
Look at Jimmy bragging about his ratio.
I know how to work this game. Game, man. It's all it is. It's like a video game you play. Like, I just gotta do this to get this.
Yep. and avoid the people that want to do what you're doing and will fucking hate on you. I mean, that was that movie we that was recommended through this podcast, the Heckler film. That's what that was about.
Yeah, I liked it. I watched it recently.
It's like, people that want to do what you're doing will hate on you, most likely, because you're doing what they want to do, and they were too afraid to do it, so then they're going to fucking throw pot shots from, you know. I mean, yeah. I'm sure there's fucking people. I know there's people that read my blog and watch YouTube just to hate on me, just to look for a misstep, to be like, oh, you did it wrong. You're fucked up. You suck. And I'm sure they listen to this podcast, too.
Bastards judging us.
So eat a dick. Several, in fact.
A lot of them.
And, you know, for people like that, it's like, you know, the sooner you just fucking admit to the truth, like, look, it's not me. It's not Jimmy Screamer Claus. It's not anybody else you're fucking bitching about on the internet. It's you. And the sooner you realize it's you and do something about it and stop blaming other people or trying to defer your bullshit, you know, you'll be closer to being happy and making your dreams come true. But to fucking just hate on other people, because, dude, it, you know, when you hate on other people, it's not a good vibe to go into making your own work. I found, you know, if I'm like, if I see something that's cool and I'm like, wow, this dude's awesome, this shit is dope, like, then I'm inspired and I go work. But if I'm hating on stuff, that's not a good attitude to go into doing your own things. But I understand why people do it, because they hope to create like a flame war, some drama, and then they have this distraction, you know, that they can use to procrastinate or not do their own shit. And if you do that, you're just fucking weak.
Weak.
Because I had some dude like bitching about the lip sync or like my anime, and it's some fucking hater dude who just tries to pick ass shit, and it's just like, really, dude? Okay.
Oh, it's a guy who's you've seen before?
I think so. I don't really remember, but I think so. And it's like, you know, yeah, really? Gonna come, like, try to tell me what I'm doing wrong when I really don't give a shit? Because, dude, I don't give a shit about lip sync. It's like, really? If the fucking phenomes or phonomes, whatever, are bugging you, then, dude, you don't like my shit anyway. Like, you know, I've watched, you probably did, you know, I grew up watching, like, B-movies or shit that was bad, technically.
Exactly.
Like, fucking puppets talking, dude. Where's their lip sync? Do they have realistic phenomes or mouth shapes? No.
And people love Kermit.
Yeah, just like, I understand it is not a real thing. No matter what you do, your fucking animated character is not real. Like, you have to use your imagination. So it's just like, yes, I understand a mouth is moving. There is a voice. This character is using this voice. That's all I care about expressing. Not going to be like, oh my God, look at the fucking transitions between the mouth shapes. Because the only people that care about that are fucking extreme CG 3D animation geeks who probably aren't that good anyway. And they're just like, well, if I could, I'll make my film if I could do that. Once I'm able to get that level of quality, I'll do it. I'm going to keep doing tests. But until then, no. No. You're not at that level of quality. No, this is unacceptable. You should stop making your film. Slow down. You're doing it too fast.
They told me in film school that this was not correct.
Yeah, so those people, like, come on. Really? And if you're telling yourself that, like, come on. Really? Like, people are going to watch your movie and be like, well, the mood is amazing. This character's, the story's amazing. Oh, the lip sync. Fuck you.
He did not render that wall correctly.
Yeah, like, dude, then your movie sucks. But people like to hang on to that shit like an excuse. It's not because my idea sucks and it's totally unoriginal and cliche and fucking, like, things I've seen 1,000 times before. It's because of lip sync. The fuck out of here. The fuck out of
Whoa. What the hell was that? That's scary. The computer started talking to me.
Because, you know, with anybody's movie, I'd rather see your movie next year in some imperfect state with imperfect lip sync than fucking a perfect one in 10 years.
Uh-huh.
And if you're creating shit, it's like, yeah, dude, how long do you want to spend? You know, I mean, what's long... How does time... kills me on projects. Like, Heartstring Marionette, the time that took, like, fuck that. I never want to do that.
Yeah, I know. Takes it out of you.
Yeah, and then people, I guess, don't understand that. It's like, hey, you know, we're going to make another one. Yeah. It's not like...
They get better. That's the thing. It's like, as long as they get better.
Yeah, as long as they get better in some way. And it's like, hey, look, Heartstring Marionette had virtually no lip sync at all. Here's one that has lip sync. Okay. Next movie, you know, you stack like that. All right, I'll pay more attention to it. But
yeah, you add something each time. This time I'm doing more hair renders. And
mm-hmm. But I guess what people, it's like in the Heckler movie where people are like, well, I'm just telling you this stuff, man, because I care about you or I just want to help you.
Uh-huh.
And it's like, if you really wanted to help me with my lip sync, you know what? Make a fucking tutorial. Show me your lip sync.
Mm-hmm.
Send a link here. Here's how to use an automatic lip sync technique and have accurate mouth shapes. Here's how you do it. This is what I did.
Mm-hmm.
But to just have a random voice of complaining, no, you're getting me wrong. It's like, it's fucking useless. It's worthless. I don't want to hear that shit.
I'm on your side, bro.
Well, I'm just
with you.
I'm just letting people know. Because if you become that person, then you're just a little bitch on the internet.
Don't be a bitch on the internet.
Because as time goes forward, like, I'm not going to fucking stop making movies, and I'm only going to get better. And I know where I'm headed, and then, you know, people are going to go back on the internet and be like, oh, look at this fucking idiot complaining about the lip sync.
I just don't even let it get to me. Fuck those people. I don't care.
Well, anger and fire and, like, you know, astrologically, Jimmy, my sign is triple fire. So
I gotta breathe the fire.
So I'm powered by fire. Like, a lot of my motivation is like, I'll show you fuckers. Like, you don't know, you know, in my whole life. So I have chips on my shoulders.
I've just realized I've, like, my entire life I've just been so far on the outside of everything that, like, it just doesn't even matter to me. I've just always been on some whole other place.
Really?
Yeah. I'm used to just not fitting in, so I'm always just like, whatever, I don't care.
I guess what the reason it pisses me off so much is that, like, it's not going to stop me. It's actually going to make me fucking work harder. Mm-hmm. But it's because I know people, like, in my family and close to me who, you know, at some point some asshole came at them with that shit and it changed them and it hurt them and prevented mm-hmm. them from, you know, stunted their development. And I just want to fucking, like, say my piece so that hopefully other people, like, if there's some kid out there who's, like, 15... making animations, and then maybe people grow up with thicker skins now because the internet, and just it bounces off them. They don't give a shit. But, you know, it's like, this fucking sucks, blah 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 blah, and then you forget about your idea and what inspired you, and you just start worrying about technical things, and it's like, that's fucking lame.
Yeah, but I mean, it's also how you filter out the people who aren't meant to do it too, I think.
Yeah,
if you can't take that part of it. Like, I remember reading a filmmaking book when I first started out where it said something like, if you're the type of person who could stand on the corner in your underwear holding a sign with written some sort of gibberish on it, then, you know, you're ready to be a filmmaker, something to that effect. It's like, you just can't be embarrassed. You just gotta not give a fuck. And I was like, hey, I don't give a fuck. I'm good at this. I can do this. So that helped me out a lot. Because at that point, I was already playing shows in my underwear covered in fake blood. I was like, I'm doing that already. Fuck yeah, first step already done.
I got this film thing in the bag.
The goal gets easier from here.
Yeah, I guess it's just something that I've seen so much, and I guess I'm just I love arguing, you know, I'm a combative person. So, like, if someone...
See, that's, I'm the opposite. I'm just like, I don't want to argue with you. I'll agree with you. I'm like, yeah, I suck. You're right. Can I go now? Can this be over?
Yeah, well, and no one has ever said anything like that to me in person,
mm-hmm.
you know, because they won't.
They have to me at shows. I've had people say shit to me at shows, like, right to my face.
Film stuff?
No, I mean, like, doing music.
Oh.
But I would play shows and stuff like that, yeah, for sure. I had people come up to me afterwards and tell me I suck.
Did you flip them off to their face, like Nick Diaz?
No, I didn't. I was just like, whatever. I didn't care.
So why don't we care, Jimmy?
I don't know. I don't care about a whole lot of things. I'm just a careless person.
Well, I look
I'm
at
just,
it.
I'm so absorbed in my own little world. Like, I don't even consider myself a part of a regular society. I'm just so far on the outside all the time that it's just like I don't care about being accepted.
Yeah, it's, I guess I don't really care, but I like, so if someone came to me, I'd be like, well, fuck you. Who are you? What the fuck have you done? Well, what are you producing besides hot air, urine, and excrement? Mm-hmm. Well, I'm fuck you. So, yeah. Because I was thinking about that, it's like most people, you live your whole life, if you're just working a job, whatever, you're generating, well, you're you're not creating anything. You're not creating currency. You're like earning currency.
Mm-hmm.
So the only thing you're really fucking creating is hot air from the shit you're saying, like, I'm gonna do this and I'm doing that, and urine and fecal matter.
And kids.
Right? And yeah, and fucking offspring. I mean, semen, which leads to this other thing. So it's like, if you want to be a creative person or you want to make stuff, like, think about what are you making right now besides, if you're just talking about it, you're creating hot air. Mm-hmm. Or you're not even, whatever, you're probably not even creating that. You're just expelling it. You're processing oxygen and fucking expelling CO2 that's heated up, hot air, urine, and fecal matter.
<'Cause>, best analogy ever.
So
I'm with you. I like this. I like this class.
Well, it is. It's like if someone comes, you know, like they're like, you need to do this and that. And I'm like, well, what are you creating besides fucking hot air, urine, and fecal matter? Like, hey, I'm making movies and books and fucking music and all this shit. Like, I'm creating more than feces. So, like, come on. Create more than fucking bodily fluids and excrement, and then maybe we can talk.
Maybe then we can talk.
Because, I mean, I've had it in my life where people try to tell me what I should be doing and what I'm doing wrong, and all they create is hot air, urine, and fecal matter. So it's just like...
Yeah, all the time.
Yeah, it's like...
That's just when you know they don't count. It's like, whatever. I don't care.
Yeah. So anybody out there...
Have fun getting up at 7 o'clock tomorrow. I'm going to sleep until 2.
Yeah, like, anybody out there that needs any misanthropic advice or fuel, you know, just like my quote, a person's advice can only take them as far as they've gotten. So now you have that one to think about. Think about what they're creating, these people that are trying to tell you what you should do. And if it's just hot air, urine, and fecal matter, like, if that's what you want to be as a human being, like, exchanging your time and energy for currency, which we'll have to do in some form at some point, and then, you know, creating hot air, urine, and fecal matter, like, yeah, think about it.
You need to put both of those catchphrases on the same business card on reverse sides. So depending on who you're talking to, you're like, oh, no, flip it over. This one's for you. You'll relate more to this side.
Because, dude, you know, like, I think I talked about that in the podcast, right? Reading obituaries. Have you talked about that? Like, read fucking obituaries of regular people. They were a loving husband and father of these children. They worked here. Now they're dead.
Didn't collect their pension.
Like, what the fuck? Really? Is that what you want to be? Is that all you want to, like, you're gifted this existence for some reason to do something, and that's what you're going to do with it? Like, I mean, granted, we're all here because people had children, but that's their existence and path, not ours. But if you become fucking become aware and like, hey, I have free will. I can do different things if I choose to. But I think as a species or whatever the fuck humans are, we should
just
be...
Just wipe us out already. Where's the aliens? Come on.
We should be striving to create more than hot air, urine, and fecal matter.
Well, I mean, we are, right? We're on task.
Us?
Yeah.
Yeah, we're making stuff.
See, we're good then. We're all good.
I created 20 shots just yesterday.
Don't worry about the normies.
And now I'm starting on a new animated music video for Rabbit Junk, which I'm going to create within the week.
See?
And then we're going to go to Texas, where someone else paid for the fucking flight and all that shit. We're just going to show up and eat fucking tacos and stuff and have a great time.
Yeah, tacos.
Yeah. And then we're going to come back and work on our shit some more.
Boo.
Yeah.
Come back. I have to come back to winter.
Oh, well, I'm going to Iceland next month, too, so that's more winter than your winter.
I don't believe that.
Yeah, it is. It's like frozen there, dude. I can wear every fucking piece of clothing I own, and the wind just goes... And my soul quivers.
Your soul quivers.
Yep.
Poor M.Dot's soul.
I know. I have to go to Iceland and visit my girlfriend. Oh, no.
I have to go feel feelings.
Yeah. We're doing it wrong. So, yeah. Create more than that. Because, you know, when you're going to sleep and, like, you know, you're jerking off and jizzing on yourself and just creating, you know, talking about doing stuff and creating urine and fecal matter and jizzing on yourself, it's like, yeah, that can get pretty depressing. So fucking make something. start writing something or make some fucking, I don't know, I kind of make it sound like the only thing to do is create art, but, you know, fucking program, code, do something.
Yes.
Just because, you know, like, the kids, Jimmy, the kids.
They're the children.
They look up to fucking people that are older, if you're an uncle or a brother or whatever, and it's like, hey, come on, you gotta show fucking kids that there's something more in life than just fucking being a reproductive bucket of human excrement.
Oh.
You like that one?
Yeah, that was a good one, too. It's a lot of good shit analogies.
Because think about it. Like, hey, like, if you took, like, someone's output for a year, you would have several buckets of piss, several fucking, like, huge fucking things of piss, several barrels of shit, fucking what? Saliva, semen, fucking vaginal secretions, if they're a
this
woman.
This all sounds like a party to me, bro. I don't know what, like, your problem is.
No. Maybe we should do that. Like, just not actually keep it in buckets, but...
I have a good story.
Like, what do people create? And then, like, oh, I wrote 3 books. Okay, put those books there. Or I fucking hot 1,000 pages. I coded these programs. I built these orphanages. Or I fucking designed this house or whatever. And I built, like, you know, look at those things. And I kind of look at your life like that. What did you create? Because that's what I do at the end of every year. I was like, what did I do with this year of my life? And, you know, what do I want to do this coming year? And then that's how I kind of plan shit out.
I really want to tell a story about a bucket of semen now that you said that word.
I've seen those pictures, like, on fucking on, like, the internet, like, dudes saving their jizz for, like, years and shit.
Well, I used to have a roommate who was saving it in a jar under his bed for a while. And then we got him really, really drunk one night. We convinced him to cook it up on the stove and snort it.
Oh, did he?
Yeah. I have a video of it.
Why did he save his jizz?
I don't know. Because he's a fucking freak.
Yeah, why would
he? Because those are the kinds of people I know. That's why.
Well, because, see, you know, it's not like we're all, like, sick somehow. So I'm just trying to understand, why would you save your jizz?
He thought it was funny. It was just a joke to him. And then, like, after he had it for a while, I was like, well, what do I do with this now? We, you know, we had ideas.
But why wouldn't you just fill it with, like, water and Elmer's glue and say it was your jizz if you just wanted it to be funny?
Oh, well, because we're hardcore.
So he saved his jizz. Check it out. A jizz in this jar.
And he would show it to us all the time. Like, look how full the jar is now. We're like, that's great. Good for you.
He's like, my future wife is going to be the woman that accepts this jar of jizz as a gift on our first date.
You'd be surprised. Some girls are like, hey,
you
that's
produce
cool.
A lot of semen.
And you're saving it. You're good for you.
Wow.
I mean, not the right types of girls, but, you know, it's all subjective.
Yeah. I mean, whether you want your life ruined or not, you know, for temporarily or whatever. So,
yeah.
So
that happens.
Yeah. Well, Jimmy, what are you getting on to?
And on that note,
well, I got like I'm doing. You know, I'm animating right now. Well, I'm doing the rabbit junk, but there's a couple voice actors I'm still, like, talking to, and they're like, my voice, check my voice, is a nightmare. Hey, Jimmy Screamer Claus is a voice in I Am Nightmare Now.
I am monsters.
You are.
I destroy things in the movie too.
Yep. So we did that. We added Jimmy to the cast this past week.
Woohoo! I'm a real person.
So now, when the film plays at Fancy Pantsy Festival Pantsy, we can wear tuxedos and go.
Yes, exactly. Salvation Army tuxedos.
But I don't know if my kids' movie's a kids' movie anymore.
No?
It's you know, like, there's those movies like Coraline and I think the fucking Paranorman. They're trying to be maybe like teenager movies.
Mm-hmm.
But they fucking wimp out. Like, come on, really? Yeah, they're fucking, what, teenagers that are like 4? Are you a teenager at 4? No. So
I've been watching those this week. Like, all those kids 3D movies, because there's so many of them now.
Yeah, those, I like them. Like, I like those better than the other ones, but they're just like, dude, where's the edge? There's fucking no edge. The edge is all dull. It's like a dull knife. So
yeah.
I think this one, it's a fucking sharp knife teen movie.
So you're going for more of a teen kind of movie?
I don't know. No, I mean, I just made it. It's like it has kids in it, so I just, you know, like assumed, oh, well, kids will like it. And then it's so scary. I'm like, well, it might be too scary for kids. Maybe teenagers. So
there you go.
I don't know.
It's a crazy kid. Some kids that are crazy.
Because, you know,
I was watching scary movies as a kid.
If you're like us, you know, and weirdos in life as adults, I think, dude, we're kind of like teenagers forever.
Yeah.
Because it's like, no one understands us. And, you know, being a misanthrope, you're kind of like, at least for me being a teenager, or some people have totally normal teenager dumbs that don't get all misanthropic and hating themselves in the world. But I think, yeah, I'm sort of a forever teenager, so.
That should be our new podcast, but Forever Teenagers.
It would sound like a porn site or something.
Well, kind of is.
Forever Teen.
Well, you're saying this podcast isn't sexy?
No, I didn't say that. I mean,
I think people are getting off to it all the time, bro.
Because we do it fully nude.
Exactly.
Yep, totally. Who am I kidding? I'm wearing the same fucking 6 layers of clothes I went to sleep in 3 days ago.
6 layers? Why are you overdressed?
No, wait, 1, 2, not 3 layers. 3 layers of clothes.
It's not supposed to be cold there.
It's, I don't know, I get in my animator, like, homeless guy kind of thing, where I just wear the same clothes for, like, 4 days in a row.
Yeah, me too.
And I just go to sleep in my clothes, like, I don't even get in a bed. Like, I just sleep on top of a bed, because I'm like, I don't want to have to get all under the covers, because I don't have to get out of them, and I just need to get up and work.
I don't want to get comfortable.
Yeah, so, like, I just sleep on the bed in my clothes, and then get up and go back to work, and then go to sleep on the bed, and, like, yeah.
Doesn't sound like a very healthy cycle.
It's actually, dude, I think I'm really healthy. And somehow I have, like, I've had a girlfriend, a really awesome girlfriend for like 6 years now, even though I didn't change my clothes in 3 days and sleep on top of the bed. But yeah, it's possible. It's possible, guys. It's
possible, guys.
It happens. Can be a disgusting bachelor frog and still make it work. So yeah. And I'm looking forward to hanging out with you in real life, Jimmy.
Yeah, man. You'll see how much of a homeless bastard I look like, too.
You're probably like 7 feet tall, right?
I'm pretty short. Shortish. I'm like 5'10"-ish.
Oh, you're taller than me. I'm 5'8".
Really?
Yep.
Well, we might be around the same height.
Everyone that meets me in person like, oh, I thought you'd be taller. I'm like, all right.
Oh.
I mean, I don't care. We live longer. Huh.
Do we?
Yeah, tall people like die of heart attacks and shit, like... Yeah, the lifespan is way shorter for tall people.
My friend was actually telling me that buckethead guy, he's really tall, and he had to get some sort of surgery because he was too tall. And it was, like, fucking his skin up or his body up or something.
Yeah, no, not to be, you know, and people will say, well, you're just saying that because you're short and not makes feel better. It's like, no, you got the stats, bro. Check it out. That's why fucking Japanese people have the fucking longest lifespans. Because we're just running around with our short little legs, but we can just run around forever. What you tall people are like, I'll just step way longer than you, and oh, I'm dead.
Yeah, their balance is worse. They're top heavy.
So now I just tell people if they say that, I'm like, well, my ego's 50 feet tall, though, so. It's not, but I just pretend.
Oh.
But yeah, so... And I'm sure Josh is listening to this, so we're going to be hanging out with Josh. I think we're staying in Josh's house.
Staying in somebody's house.
Yeah, we're going to go through their
somebody's
closet.
Somebody's abducting us.
Right, Jimmy?
Yeah.
When they're not around, we'll go through their closet.
Steal stuff.
Yeah.
Sell it on the black market.
Yeah, for Bitcoin.
No, we'll steal it, and then they'll hire us as investigators to find it, and then we'll find it and charge them.
We're just kidding, Josh. We're not going to rob you.
It's a good racket.
Jimmy and I are not felons.
Yeah.
Right? Are you a felon, Jimmy?
No, I'm not.
Yeah, me neither. So
I have friends who are felons, but I am not one of them.
Yeah, I have a couple friends who went to prison and are sex offenders. Well, they're not friends. People I knew from school.
Bastards.
My old mailman's a sex offender. He was like the friendliest guy. Like,
of course, that's how he sex offended.
He would talk to everybody, and everybody liked him, and then the dude, like, disappeared, and it's like, oh, he got transferred, and then, like, one day I just looked on the Megan's list, like, when I had the studio down near the downtown, and then, like, I was like, what the fuck? And the dude is a sex offender. So I was
see
like,
what happens?
That's a vacation he took in prison.
It's always the people that are nice and friendly that end up doing that shit.
Yeah, it's just because, you know, us as men, he was cool with me as a man. He wasn't creepy at all. Mm-hmm. Like, so I wouldn't think of anything. But then, you know, men have men relationships with men, and then they have their persona, their relationship with the women, and dudes can be totally cool with other dudes and just totally be freak show fuck creeps of women. So
yep.
He like had sex with like some 13-year-old or something, and he was like 50.
Oh boy.
Or something. So
I watched To Catch a Predator a lot. That's one of my favorite shows.
That's where they set the dudes up.
Yeah, I love that show.
Yeah, it's creepy.
They read their horrible chat logs and stuff. It's brilliant, really. Brilliant television.
Yeah, so watch out, people. Know that there's two sides to every man and woman. How they deal with the opposite sex. Or if they're...
There's plenty of crazy women out there, too.
Yeah, for sure.
They never show up on those sex offender shows, but there's plenty of crazies.
Yeah, but I'm all, like, conditioned. I'm like, oh, women aren't as bad as men, so... Well, I shouldn't say that. No, I shouldn't say that.
Let me introduce you to some people.
I know how crazy they are. I'm just, you know, yeah. I'm just trying to look at the bright side, you know?
Uh-huh.
Like that song. Oh, and thanks to Jimmy, he recommended a band to me called Those Poor Bastards.
Yes.
Which are awesome. It's like evil country. It's like death country, and I've been listening to, and they have that song. Because people are good. Bullshit! Like, yeah.
They have another band, too, Lonesome Wide and the Holy Spooks. It's a little more acoustic.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's like it's the same people, but it's not as heavy.
I'm going to have to check that out, because Those Poor Bastards is awesome. Because if we were raised like in a religious community or neighborhood or whatever, and it's like these dudes are pretty much calling the bullshit.
Yeah, like every song's like some religious hymn.
Yeah, it's like, but Jesus will save us, and like, yeah. And it's really dark and kind of like probably what it was like to be in like a Wild West town, like for real.
Mm-hmm.
That's what it sounds like to me. Like the Dude the Coward song is a song about a guy who saw a woman get killed by his friend, but he's too afraid to say anything. And he's just like, yeah, it's great listening for working.
Great to listen in for work.
Actually, I've heard too, Jimmy, that people say that this podcast is great to animate too.
Oh, well, good for them and us.
So if you're animating right now, switch that keyframe to linear interpolation. Just do it, okay? Just for that one key, because, you know, Adam Dot Strange recommended on the podcast you're listening to right now. You have any recommendations, Jimmy?
Put a pink light in there somewhere.
Yeah, all right. Pink light, one pink linear light. Keyframe.
Yeah.
Do it.
Do it. Every shot.
So yeah, I don't know what happened. I contacted like a bunch of guests, and then kind of their schedules fell out of place, and I haven't been able to reschedule them or get them on here. But
and then mine too.
Oh, to the people that are listening, I think it was Klaus who, or a couple people asked for like that. What's that woman's name? Nina Paley. So I emailed Nina Paley. She never responded. So whoever asked me to get her, I did try to get her, but she never responded for whatever reason. And then
is that the Sings the Blues girl?
Yeah. So she never replied. So she's not interested in being on the show. And then I emailed the Zoltan Sosai guy, the guy who did that movie. I don't remember the name of it now, but he never responded either. For whatever reason, he doesn't want to do it. And then someone told me to contact this other guy, the sick animation dude. And he responded, but said he didn't have anything to talk about. So he's not going to be on, and who else? So yeah, if there's more people you want us to try to get on the show, just leave a message on the Facebook or email me or Jimmy or whatever, and I'll go out there because I have like a boilerplate, we'd like you to be on our show email that I send out. So
do it up, people.
I'm thinking the intro to the show might turn a lot of fucking people off if they're all like uppity or whatever.
Why is that?
Because it's like, because nobody fucking cares. That's why you gotta make your movie yourself. Like, you know, people that are all like, oh, because they would think, I mean, we wouldn't, right? But there's some people that are only into like official shit or are all fucking uppity. So, dude, it's like when I put out that first Heartstring Marionette trailer, I saw that some people had posted and they're like, I would check out this movie, but there's cursing in the trailer, so I'm not. Oh. It's like, fucking get over yourself, you fucking... Ugh. So, yeah. there's people out there that are like, oh, there's cursing. Oh, well, yeah, I can't be a part of this because, oh, yeah.
Lame.
So we don't want those motherfuckers on anyway.
Exactly. We don't need them.
And I won't say, I won't name any names, but if you ask, if you request someone to be on the show, even if I think they fucking suck and I don't like them, I'll ask them anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So... I'm doing.
Is there a rival? Is there an M. Strange rival I don't know about?
No, I wouldn't hate someone for being a rival if I just thought they sucked then and I didn't like their shit.
I was hoping there was a rival I didn't know about.
No. No, there's a bunch of rappers named M.
Are there?
Mm-hmm. None of them are very good, but
of course.
But no, so I'll ask.
Dot Strange. They're just M.
Yeah. And they don't even know it means mega damage over time. Because that's what my films and rhymes do to your mind.
Exactly. They don't damage over time.
Yeah.
They just fucking limp wrist slap.
Yep. And it's also Department of Transportation. And Michigan Department of Transportation. Seriously.
That's what you should start telling people it stands for.
So people have emailed me like, oh, when I'm driving in my fucking state, like I think of you when I see the signs because it says MDOT. So yeah, if you guys have anybody you want me to ask to be on the show, let us know and I'll ask them no matter what, no matter who they be.
You're talking like there's someone that you don't want to ask.
No.
Like that there's already like a person on the shit list.
No, well.
You're like, I'll fucking do it if I have to.
Well, Jimmy, I might be doing it in past tense, if you know what I mean.
Uh-huh.
So yeah. But, you know, because here I serve as not me as an artist, animator, dude with hella attitude. I am trying to be the host of a show about filmmaking and animation.
Uh-huh.
So if the audience or people are listening want something, then I put my personal feelings and opinions aside.
You're backing yourself into a corner here, man. Tell you, there's some sort of shit surfacing right now that there's somebody out there that MDOT's got a fucking he's gunning for. We just don't know who it is yet. We got to solve this mystery.
No, it's easy to solve. I'm saying it. I'm saying this in past tense.
I don't know what that means.
So I'm saying this after the fact. So there may be somebody who someone asked me to be on the show already.
Was it me?
No.
Oh. I have no idea what's going on.
I just hate everyone.
I'm really confused right now.
Okay.
I just know somebody's got their shit list. Got on your shit list.
Yeah. Well, you know, like, I don't know. I'm a very opinionated person.
This is true.
That's why I make movies. If you think shit sucks and you don't like what people are doing, then make your own. So I make my own. There's a lot of stuff that I don't like that I think is fucking crap. That I think is taking the easy way out and being lazy. Or people that take way too much credit and blow themselves out of proportion for the things that they've done. And that just fucking, you know, gets under my skin. It's like, come on. It's not that fucking hard. So, yeah. Yeah.
Yes.
Love me or hate me, I'm doing damage over time, motherfuckers.
Select M. Strange next time you play your RPG. He does damage over time.
That's right. Fire, poison.
Good to have him in your party.
I got fire. I got fucking poison fire.
See? Poison fire. They burn and poison at the same time. They vomit fire from the poison. That burns their insides.
Wait, you know what? Now, though, I should take that back. Because people are like, well, I don't know. I don't want to ask MDOT to interview people if you think they suck. And he hates them.
If anybody can figure out who MDOT's rival is, contact me instead of him. I'll set something up. I'm going to set up a boxing match. See how long it takes until it starts going south.
But look, bitch.
And just sit back and be in awe of it.
Well, you know, I punch and kick and knee a punching bag every day.
Yes.
I'm training.
Well, we gotta see your verbal punching bag skills.
It'll get ugly.
That's what I want.
I'll make it ugly real fast.
I want to start being the ringmaster.
Well, because the way
fight, minions, fight.
the way I grew up and the way I was raised in my family, we like arguing and we'll say fucking anything to win an argument. No matter if it has to do with people living, dying, having horrible fucking afflictions, diseases, whatever. We don't give a shit.
You just gotta win.
Yep.
So you're like that. You're like that Emilio Estevez in The Breakfast Club.
So like, if your own family, like if your own mother can tell you that you're a piece of shit and you should just go kill yourself and like stuff like that, or whatever, and you can take that and just like, yeah, whatever. Then anything anyone else says is just like, yeah, come on.
See, then those internet forum kids really don't matter.
Well, it's not. It's just like, it's really for the fact, like I said, because there's other people that it may hurt or harm.
Yeah.
In a negative way, that it may, instead like me, where it gets me angry and then I'm like, well, fuck you, I'll show you. There's other people who will fucking pull back. Mm-hmm. So if I can do my piece to smack those people down so they don't do it to anyone else, then
fight the power.
That's right.
Fight the power.
That's right.
Damn the man.
So yeah, I'm training. I'm training for exercise. Because don't you want to do like a Juve Bowl one day?
I was actually just watching that documentary when you called. I'm halfway through it now. The Raging Bull.
I've never seen that one. I just saw in Heckler where he was beating his critics' asses, and I thought that was awesome.
So far, it's just about his filmmaking career. It hasn't really. And he comes on every now and then like, fuck the critics, what have they ever done?
Yeah, and he actually got to beat their asses.
Yeah. I'm guessing that's in this documentary at some point. I'm only 30 minutes into it.
I have a lot of violent fantasies, like, mm-hmm. all the time. And some of my violent fantasies were, like beating the hell out of, like, other filmmakers or, like, film critics or festival people and stuff like that, so.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Which is kind of hard, you know, to do it without getting arrested now because of cell phones, smartphones, and all that. So it's really hard to, like, go to a film festival or a thing and like beat someone's ass.
It's kind of hard to go to events and start beating people up.
Yeah. So I haven't done that, but
I haven't done it yet.
There was a video game musician out there who I was like 5 seconds away from like going to his concert and like beating his ass on stage.
Really? He pushed you that far?
Yeah. But luckily there was some woman around that was like, no, don't do it, no, but and I was like,
don't
okay.
Don't beat him on his stage.
Yeah.
Don't ruin his pretty face.
Yeah, God, why am I so aggressive? It must be the steroids I'm taking.
And me and all the steroids.
No, I
just stop chopping down all those steaks, bro. Eat a salad now and then.
Salad, I don't need that. I'm gonna get diverticulitis like Brock Lesnar. You know about that, right? Diverticulitis?
No, what's that?
Friend's mom had that too. So if you don't eat fiber, that's why people out there, you need to get your fiber. Psyllium husks is the cheapest and easiest form of fiber if you don't want to eat vegetables. And so what happens is that the stuff in your colon or in your intestines is not being cleared out or passed through because you're not getting enough fiber. So then food like sticks to the walls and just starts rotting, right? And then it fucking ulcerates the side of the intestine, actually makes a hole in it. So then your food and your fecal matter starts tunneling out of your intestines and into your body cavity.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, poisoning yourself.
That's pretty crazy.
Yeah, so like the pro wrestler and MMA fighter Brock Lesnar had that and he almost died because he was all macho. I just eat steak. Fuck vegetables, for I just eat steak, that's for whatever. And then, like, it's like, yeah, you almost died from shitting yourself to death. So, and I know someone else who happened to someone in their family where they would try to go to the bathroom and nothing would come out for, like, weeks.
Mm-hmm.
And then they went to a doctor and was like, you're filling yourself up with shit.
My childhood friend's mom died like that, actually.
Yeah, it's terrible. Same thing. So, people out there, fiber.
Fiber.
I know it's weird that you're listening to the Forever Alone Filmmaking Podcast and this animator dude, M. Strange, is talking
about fiber. Who's just talking about beating up festival directors.
Yeah, but seriously.
He says eat fiber.
Psyllium
husks. Eat your fiber, kids.
Well, you know, it's like I care about the people that I care about and I really fucking hate the people that I don't like.
Yeah.
It's like I'll love people to death or just want to kill them.
Have you seen that movie Bronson yet?
No. Oh, or that the kind of fake kind of documentary thing.
I guess it's kind of like, it's not really a documentary, but yeah, it's like the life of this prisoner who just fights everyone.
No.
That's pretty crazy. It's by the same guy who made Drive.
So if this is kind of a lesson, like, you know, when I was like a teenager in high school, like I was all into athletics and like did all that and was all aggro or whatever. But then see, instead of going into a life of violence or fucking crime, I put it into art. So then through my animation, I'm like, rah, 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 you know, getting that stuff out through writing. So, So you don't have to do it in real life. If I didn't do it in art, then maybe I would do it in real life and I'd be in prison or some shit, but
don't do that. Yeah. Don't go to jail.
My family thought I was going to be a killer, so they're just like, sure, Michael.
They must be proud of you that you're not.
Whatever you want to do. Oh, you want to make paintings? Oh, you want to hit baseballs through the windows? Okay, fine. Just don't kill anybody.
My son's so creative.
Yeah. So, if you have the killer instinct out there, if you want to murder people, you know, turn it into that. I wrote, when I was 18, I wrote a script, a story where I killed everyone. Like, in graphic detail.
One by one.
Yeah, I killed my high school girlfriend who dumped me, and I killed, like, all these people. So, just kill people in fiction. Don't do it in real life. Channel your hate. If you're in a situation where you're frustrated as shit and can't do anything because of people, you know, write it. Just don't put it on the internet publicly where you can totally tell, you know, who's who. You know, fluff it up. Put it in a story, and then maybe you'll become, yeah, some successful author or filmmaker or something. Yeah. Because, well, today, too, you'll get fucking arrested, and they'll say you're a terrorist and shit. Yeah. Can't threaten anybody or make anything kind of violent. Or they're like, you're a killer. You're going to be a school shooter. Yeah.
Well, I might be right.
Well, but, dude, nah. I mean, everybody fucking gets angry and frustrated when they're kids. It's just part of it.
Yeah.
But I mean, if you were like that and everyone was like, "Are you? Be careful! You're a killer." Like, I think it would just make you worse. If people just let it go, like, you know, if you get busted in school, you get suspended. Like, that fucking alienates you and makes you angrier. It's like if the cops are harassing people all the time, it makes you want to fucking act out because you're pissed off. That's why there's riots in fucking neighborhoods where people get fucked with by the police.
Yeah.
Because you're tired. Like, I've been fucked with a couple times. I mean, I'm, you know, and I look fucking white. Imagine if I was fucking dark skinned. Like, yeah, I'm sure it would be like times 10. And yeah, it makes you angry, you know? So, just gotta let people be.
Leave them alone.
Yeah. Right. Well, I better get to this Rabbit Junk music video now. I'll channel my anger into the song because the song's called Break Shins to This.
Break those shins.
And it's all brr, brr. Because so, J.P. Anderson, the dude from Rabbit Junk, is so aggro, he named the song Break Shins to This because he actually broke his fucking shin stomp dancing at a show recently. Believe that?
That's pretty crazy.
So, knowing that, and if I've heard his music, he's a pretty intense fucking dude. So, So I'm going to get to Break Shins to This. Thanks for being on the show again, Jimmy. Thanks for doing the show.
No problem.
Thanks for being around. You got any words you want to throw out before we end this bitch?
Words are good and words are bad. That's
exactly
the end.
Exactly. I couldn't have said it better myself. So, people out there, please, this upcoming year, create something more than hot air, urine, and fecal matter, whatever it may be. Think about your obituary. Think about it.
Think about it.
Until then, Forever Alone Filmmaking, saying goodbye.
Fine stuff.
Thank you for listening to the Forever Alone Filmmaking Podcast. If you have any questions or comments, please ask them wherever this shite is posted. Subscribe to the podcast in iTunes or tell a friend, if you have any. But if you don't, it ain't no thing, wanker. Make your movies anyway. It isn't easy, but somebody has to do it. Because Hollywood fucking sucks.